both positive and negative validation on the basis of where it's coming from. So what I mean is that just because a photograph has got 500 likes on Instagram, as opposed to the other photograph that's got 12 likes, that doesn't mean that the picture that's got 500 likes is supremely better. It probably means it's more popular, it probably means it's more uniform, regular, boring, perfect. Maybe not a better photograph. And there'll always be people who'll praise you to the skies because they love you or they like you or they, you know, something of that sort. Or they will criticize you because, again, some negative emotion rather than a criticism of the work. So I think as younger photographers, and in our country, you're a young politician when you're 47. So as young photographers of whatever age, whether you're in your 20s or your 30s, like Orko and me here, I think it's very important about where we get any validation from, positive and negative. Sure, sometimes somebody without any background in photography may say the most, they may say something very offhand and suddenly you go like, oh my God, that's an incredible observation. That does happen. But when it comes to downright criticism or positive criticism or even praise, my only question remains why? Because that sort of helps me filter what it could mean and whether how I should try and implement it in the future. And you can go ahead and criticize.
No, I loved your work.
Thank you. Yes, please, sir.
I don't know your name. I was quite late coming
Raj.
Here.
Hi,
okay.
Raj.
Hi, Raj. Hi, folks. I've gone through the work, and they were quite interesting. Although I'm nowhere related to photography, I'm basically a professor of management. But I'd like to understand from you folks, anybody can, answer me. These days with the advent of social media, people have a trend of taking selfies and posting. Because I do a lot of study on virtual behavior and virtual personality. From a photography perspective, do you have any way of analyzing an individual's personality if he or she is quite frequently, posting their selfies in different poses with different reactions and stuff like that?
I think there are two answers to the question. Firstly, everybody either loves or hates selfies. Everyone will say hate selfies because this is a photography festival. But over the past 2 days, I've also seen how much we all love selfies. So there are, I think, two responses to your question. Because I can largely speak as a photographer and not a psychologist. So does it really explain somebody's psychology? To me, it says that they're just full of themselves, they're narcissistic. Nothing wrong with that. My work is full of myself. Right, I can't call anyone narcissistic as a negative word, but to me it seems like self-indulgence. Seems like narcissism, which is, I guess, okay to a certain degree. As a photographer, my answer would be something very different. I do not understand when photographers get irritated with selfies. Selfies are not pretending to be art. Selfies are not pretending to be photography. They are photographs, yes. But is it photography? I'm being a little judgmental and saying it's not photography, but it's not having those aspirations or pretensions most of the time. It's like I'll be sitting in class and I want to talk to my friend who's on the first bench, I'm on the last bench, I'll write a small note and pass it in a chit. Is that good writing? Is that writing? Is that literature? Is that what Arundhati Roy would, write in The God of Small Things? It definitely isn't. It just not happened before. That's why people are, because technology has jumped in the deep end where this accessibility has happened. But I mean, there's a young guy over here who's been singing very beautifully every day. There's a group that sits around the bonfire and sings, which is one of the things that I love about the vibe of Egaro, by the way. Agaro, sorry. I absolutely love that. But then, you know, I also sing. I sing in my bathroom. That's a cliche way. I sometimes sing while photographing. You know, I'll be walking around some part of Bombay, and because I either sing or I talk to myself or I yell at myself. But is that singing music? It's not. Similarly, is a selfie really? Should a photographer be concerned about selfies? I don't really get the point. You can get irritated about it as a person. Like, yaar, bahut ho gaye selfies, you know, like, get done with it. But I know similarly people are irritated about me shooting. So, I guess to each his own. I don't know if that answers the question.
Also, I would like to add, yet at the same time, this genre of photography can be brought to mainstream, like people like Christina Nunes has done. When they have taken this form of photography, she was a former model who came to photography much later. So what she has done is the way she is aging, she is just portraying herself, wherein she has taken the shape of fine art as a medium. And she's shooting herself constantly, every day, each picture every day. So selfie, in a sense, it's now over-democratization of photography to each is his own, as Raj said. But yeah, it has a scope for itself again. If taken seriously, it can be brought into mainstream.
I think that's a good point. I mean, like the note-making example that I gave, there are some great letter writers. You know, there's some people who they'll write two lines to you and it'll sound like a movie dialogue and you'll go like, man, I need to treasure this note. So it's rare, but of course some people are trying to break boundaries, as Oscar said. Yes?
Hello, Raj.
Hi.
So as you said, like, lot of things intermingle when you shoot, like this goes into that and it continues. But as you showed yourself, like almost nowhere close to Clementine. So when you make a series, do you do the whole thing after you have done the shooting? Is there nothing that goes into your mind before the shoot?
Like,
which would I put in which series?
So no, it there's no correct answer to this. I'll tell you why, because there are two completely different approaches. When I don't know that the series is happening, you know, for the longest time I didn't know that Clementine had started forming. I didn't know that I had photographs of my female friends / colleagues / lovers / acquaintances that were not direct portraits and yet spoke something to me. I didn't know that. One random day, I don't know why, I was probably missing somebody and I was looking at old photographs and I go like, hey, nice. And then I remembered I shot something else. I'm like, hey, looks similar in the way that I, not in a bad way, but you know, same family. And then it sort of happened. After that, when you're aware that something is happening, I sometimes find it a little difficult. I sometimes find it a little difficult because I guess my personal strength has been the instinctive, intuitive response that isn't overthinking, and by nature I am an overthinker of the overthinkingest lot. So the moment I start overthinking, I can mess up, and then it's about again. So the way I have sort of managed to run these is that because there are multiple of them simultaneously, if I was only doing one thing, I would do it really badly, I think. Some people talk about concentrating on, like, I've been given this advice by some very well-meaning senior people, where they've said that, listen, Raj, this work is good. Why don't you concentrate on this? Why are you going and photographing these women? Your family work is outstanding. Or they are like, okay, Raj, your family work is done. You've shot a lot. Why don't you build on this body of work of women? But I mean, different perspectives. But my thing is that I would be photographing in a very forced, staccato way if I was only doing one thing. And I spoke, not against, but I spoke of my personal non-fondness for information and you know, works that deal with information and you know, conventional documentary works in that sense. But the fact is, had I not done the Goa work, I would have just been a pretentious, arty fart. For me, doing a little bit of everything has always helped me. Even my commissioned work, my little bit of peanuts that come from wherever, some of it is wedding work, some of it is NGO work, some of it is an advertising shoot, there's some fashion. So, you feel a little schizophrenic, you know, no offense in that sense, but you feel like that because, you know, you're photographing the most lavish wedding possible till 1 in the morning, and at 8 in the morning you're reporting at some rundown school, and you're trying to empathize with that couple and you're trying to empathize with these people. But if I was not doing that, I would have probably, not been shooting, I guess.
Thank you.
I'm again going to quote another photographer. I think through this, I'm not showing off my quotes, but I'm actually just showing off the photographers who I love. Prabhudo Dasgupta had said that I love the fact that my life cannot be just about one thing, but about many things. So, and that's what personally keeps me going as well.
We have one more question here.
Yes, please. Yeah.
One more question. Photography, you know, photography basically for many of the people I look around is a passion, and which gradually metamorphoses into a hobby. And what are the chances for converting that hobby into a profession for an amateur, you know, without any professional training? One. The next part of my question is, okay, in a place like India where you have freedom of expression, it's quite easy to take picture right, left and center, even, you know, without taking permission. But the place where I hail from, I'm based in the Middle East, I'm based in Dubai. Well, the pictures which you have taken are absolutely fantastic because I had stayed in Mumbai for quite long. But well, you cannot take those pictures over there, one, without taking permission, and two, because of some sensor related issues. So how do you go ahead with those pictures when you take, let's say, in the pub, in the local trains, and depicting women and all? Does it land you up in some sort of problems and stuff?
I'll deal with the two questions one by one. The first question, sir, is, I think it's a very simple answer. Is it easy for somebody to go from being a very interested amateur to being a professional photographer? It's as easy and as difficult as making anything else your profession. Is it easy to become a journalist? It's not. Is it easy to become, well, a doctor? You have to pass those exams, right? That said, is it easy to do it without professional training, as you asked? I do think it is, simply because I dare say, you know, of course, some of them have been acquaintances and friends, but I don't, I think most photo schools in the country are not that great, and even if there are some exceptions, let's not get into that debate. The fact is that there has been an entire generation or two generations of incredible photographers from India who were not formally trained. Apart from a few exceptions, maybe a Kishore Parikh was formally trained from outside, Raghu Rai wasn't. Prabhudo Dasgupta, I don't think he was. He was in advertising until one day he decided to do the shoot. Simply because, the photographer who came, was supposed to come, didn't land up. So, it's definitely possible and equally easy / equally difficult to do it without professional training, because eventually it's about you and it's a long, long process. And in that sense, it's difficult. The second thing about getting into trouble about in terms of photographing in a city, it's happened. I was detained for being a terror suspect. I was being stupid. 8 days after 2611, I was photographing near Warsaw Jetty. You know, Warsaw village. For me, it's a quaint, quiet village. You know, like I'm photographing a random pattern on the wall. And I'm like, you know, I understand security concerns, but you know, they're not going to be photographing random patterns on the wall, was my defense. But it's happened. You learn your own way to get out of the situation. Usually it's just about being, it's about knowing your rights and being firm while being super polite and super sweet. And I can usually sweet talk people. That happens to be something I've been lucky about. So another time I was suspected of blowing a Bandra Wali ceiling because I had no idea that there was a terror threat. So they had cleaned up the entire ceiling. Everyone else was evacuated. And this was 1 year after the ceiling was built. I have no idea. I walk in. There's no watchman, there's no cop, nothing. I'm like, wow, Bandra reclamation, the entire promenade empty. That never happens. I'm going to make pictures. And I kept making pictures until three cops landed off. And you learn to deal with it. It happens. With regard to photographing women, has there been trouble? No, simply because I think consent is very, very important. All these women in Clementine, absolutely every single woman who was photographed knew that she was being photographed because she was someone I was spending time with. Either with the intention of making pictures or, you know, like, oh, we're just having dinner or we're working on an article together or something of that sort. But I think people who spend time around me know that my face, while it looks rather decent, sometimes just most of the time gets replaced with a camera in front. And they learn to live with that. They get irritated, but then they ignore it like the selfies that people shoot.